Well, good evening, everybody. So good to be back here. Thanks for inviting us to come. See family out here. Just bless you, bless you. And I agree with what Pastor John said. Henry and I are feeling that there's a rumbling going on.
Yes.
Can you sense it? There's a rumbling going on in the heaven. We are right there for the greatest revival ever. And the Lord said there's one coming that more than anything mankind has ever seen. And we all get to be part of it. Glory to God.
Amen.
So my prayer tonight is that you open your heart to hear what the Lord's going to speak through Henry to you, and that will change your mind. It will change your heart. You go out of here forever different.
Amen.
Holy Spirit, move on them right
yes.
now.
Yes.
Move
yes.
on them, Father.
Yes.
And let the miracle signs and wonders start happening right there where they're sitting, without anyone even having to touch them. Father, you are the healer.
Yes.
We're crying out for miracles coming down the mountain to be released here tonight. And revelation, I believe you're going to have revelation like you've never had before. Father, give them answers they've been seeking. This is a time of change in their lives. And I bless you. I bless you all. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. You've heard me say this before, but I'm going to say it again. I found favor with God because I was given grace. Grace follows me everywhere I go. hallelujah, Lord. Praise God. Jesus. Well, anybody here love Jesus tonight?
Yeah.
I couldn't quite hear you. Anybody here love Jesus?
Yeah.
Hallelujah, Lord. Praise God. Let's get a little Holy Ghost roar going in here. Let's lift up our voices and pray in the Holy Spirit and worship in Him. I know you just had some worship, but let's get some acapella going in here right now. Let's rattle the rafters in the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord, my God. Pray in the Holy Spirit, worshiping Him, blessing His holy name, giving Him praise.
Right. Amen.
And I would like to just plant a seed of mindset of a higher realm. You don't have to wait for a prayer.
Amen. That's right.
You don't have to wait for somebody to call out.
That's right.
Because you've already been called out.
Amen.
By His stripes,
yes,
ye were healed.
Yes.
Lord.
You ought to have a mindset that your faith is so high that you could literally get healed driving in the parking lot.
Amen.
You can get healed during the announcements, during the offering. You can get healed during the worship. You can get healed during the praise and worship, during the announcements. You can get healed while the guy's preaching.
Amen. That's right.
2 years back, Gracie and I were ministering in Connecticut, a little town of Norwich, Connecticut. And we were in a relationship with the pastor there. And I was preaching. And all of a sudden, about 5 or 6 rows back, this little old lady got out in the middle of the aisleway and started running and screaming and jumping and hollering coming down the aisle.
Amen.
She was a fanatic.
Amen.
And I'm talking about 80 years old.
Hallelujah.
And the pastor was sitting up here facing the congregation. And, you know, you never know what's going on in these meetings, and you don't know who's doing what. And I turned to the pastor and I said, "Pastor, you know this lady?" Because I thought maybe she's just a lunatic, went nuts. And he looked at me and he said, "Pastor Henry, you've got a healing on your hand."
Amen.
He said, I forget her name, but he said she was in the late stages of emphysema. And she was sitting back there in her pew, row of seats, with an oxygen bottle, with the tubes in her nose. And he said, "We called her last night, and we told her she usually can't come to church because she can't drive, she can't even walk. And he said, we told her that a ministry was coming that had a powerful healing anointing, and they would really like her to be here. And if she would come, he would send some guys from the church out to the house to pick her up and bring her to church." And that morning, they literally went to her house and carried her out to the car. Drove her to church and carried her and put her in that back seat. And somewhere in there, when they spoke that word, see, they said the powerful healing people are coming, but she didn't know us from Adam's house care. I mean, it wasn't like Benny Hinn or Oral Roberts was coming to town, you know what I mean? But she received that word. They spoke that word, that a powerful healing anointing was coming. And somewhere in there, she received that word. I believe she was like the woman with issue of blood. If I can just push in, if I can just push in. And I don't know, during the announcement she's receiving, but as I was preaching, and I wasn't even preaching healing at the time, all of a sudden, she ripped those things out of her nose, comes running, she runs right around, she ran right past me, didn't pay attention to me. Right past me, went right around that way and then back to the back of the church, and she's going all the way around.
Praise
the
God.
The church went nuts, because I was the only guy in there that didn't know what was going on. And then and of course my sermon was over. And then somebody comes running up to me, "I got healed of this." And somebody that just broke out all over the church, the faith level went through the roof. A fellow that was already signed up for an heart aneurysm surgery, didn't know it, but they told me later he went back to have the surgery. When they're rechecking, the balloon on the side of his heart was gone. A young boy that couldn't play in the playground at school was running around, ran outside, ran through the parking lot, and came back and screaming, "Daddy, Daddy, Daddy, I'm healed, I'm healed, I'm healed." Faith just broke out in the name of Jesus. And I speak that here right now tonight. It's not about the preacher. It's about our faith, and it's about Jesus. He provided that healing 2,000 years ago at the cross. If we could just tap in, if we could just believe.
Thank you.
Oh, shehika halalabashi. Somebody say Jesus.
Jesus.
Somebody say healer.
Healer.
Somebody say he's my healer.
My.
And I receive him tonight.
I receive him tonight.
And right now, in agreement with that, I cancel every sickness and disease off of your body. I curse sickness and disease. I command to leave your body right now. I break every authority that tried to come on you that's a false authority, and I break it by the authority that's in the name of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. At that name, every knee shall bow. Heart disease, you bow. Diabetes, you bow right now. Arthritis and bursitis and every other kind of itis, you bow your knee. We bring your authority and give you leave off their bodies right now. In Jesus' name. I curse pain and discomfort. I curse it. I command it to leave your body. Off of your body and back to the cross. Jesus took that sickness. Jesus took that sickness. He came to set the captives free.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
In Matthew chapter 4, it says Jesus came teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every manner of sickness and every manner of disease among the people. Matthew 10, it says he called his disciples together and he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out. And he said, preach, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely you have received, freely give.
Amen.
Matthew 28, the Great Commission, as it winds up the book of Matthew, it says that he literally commissioned the whole world to do what he commanded the disciples to do. And he said, lo, I'll be with you all the way to the end.
Yes.
That brings it down to you and I right now.
Yes.
Started off with him alone, and then he commissioned the disciples, and then he told them to take it to the whole world.
Yes.
Until the end. And the end has not come yet, so that's to you and I right now.
Amen.
The ministry of Jesus is in full effect right now tonight.
Yes.
Thank
you, Lord.
Preach, the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Yes.
What do you think that's supposed to mean? That means he's here to do business right now.
How?
Right now. R-A-T-N-O-W. I'm expecting healings in here tonight. That's God to me. I'm not your healer.
Amen. Right.
Jesus is. And we're releasing Jesus here tonight. We're upholding Jesus. We're exalting Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. Somebody pray in the Holy Spirit. Just pray in the Holy Ghost. Let that kind of soul in right now. In Jesus' name. Oh, she should be Thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that sickness is leaving bodies right now. Pain and discomfort is leaving right now. I thank you, Lord, that the immune systems are kicking in under the anointing in Jesus' name. I thank you for turnaround. I thank you for shift. I thank you for healing. I thank you for help right now in Jesus' name. With long life will I bless them and show them my salvation. Because it's your word, Lord. It's your promise. Paid for by your blood. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Lord. Well, somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, dear Lord.
I gotta thank Mike for having us here tonight. and the Purcells, and John and Karen, we've been in relationship with them, like they said, for a long time. Mike's got a heart and a passion for the prophetic to be released over this area and over this region. And we have a passion for this region. And I don't know if you guys know it, but you're actually in the old Mariposa County.
Amen.
Mariposa actually birthed Madera County.
Yep.
And for many, many years up in Mariposa, we've been praying over Mariposa County to the original border. The original borders went all the way down to Los Angeles County. And the actual southeast corner of the county was, many of you have been down in the Inland Empire and driven out Interstate 15 going towards Las Vegas. Go out of San Bernardino, El Cajon Pass is the corner, was the corner of Mariposa County, and then it ran directly south over towards Buena Park in that area, and then followed the coastal range around. And came up the watershed on the coastal range all the way up to Monterey County. And, you know, that whole 11 counties have been cut out of the original Mariposa County. And the county seal in Mariposa is mother of counties. Now, I've got a map. I was going to bring it, and I forgot it, but it has the whole state and the whole original county outlined, and then the county where it is now filled in solid, just so you get the perspective. And I just said all that to say that we have a heart and we have investment praying over your region.
Amen.
Because we've been praying, I'm talking about since the 90s, for revival to the original borders of Mariposa, and of course we've been praying for California and praying for America.
Amen.
And I got to say this tonight, God bless America.
Yes.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
God bless America. I don't want to get into politics, but I have a good night too tonight.
Oh, yeah.
Church on its face and the move of God taking place.
Amen.
But the two things that I want to plant on this until before I move on to something else. There are only two nations in history that were ever formed on a covenant with God. Israel with Abrahamic covenant and America with the Mayflower Compact. I heard D. James Kennedy say one time as he was preaching at that big statue of Plymouth, Massachusetts, that big monument. And he made this statement, the Mayflower Compact was the birth certificate of America. When he said that, I said, yes, that is right. And when those, see, we had Spanish and You know, I originally came from Florida, from Newport Beach, Florida, and St. Augustine, Florida is the oldest city in America, established back in the 1500s. We had the French here, we had the Russians on the West Coast, we had people all over the place. But the fact is, in 1620, November the 11th, 1620, the Pilgrims, when they landed at Plymouth Rock, that's where the America was born. Our body politic was born. And they were Christians, and they didn't come just for religious freedom. They came to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. They came to establish a New Testament community. And in the words of that Mayflower Compact, it actually says, to the glory of God and advancement of the Christian faith, we covenant before God together.
Amen.
Well, I expect to see Bibles thrown in the air, jumping up and down, barking over the hall. Are you hearing me?
Say
it again.
November 11th?
Yeah, November the 11th.
1620. Wow.
1620. So there are only two nations established on a covenant with God, Israel and America. But here's the big one. There's only one nation in history that was birthed because of its love for God. That's America. God birthed Israel because of his love for Israel and his love for Abraham.
Right.
And I'm not talking replacement theology. Israel is the center of the universe, the King of Kings, and the reigns in the City of Peace.
That's right.
And that's Jerusalem, the center of the universe.
That's right.
When this thing is all said and done, everything swings back to Israel.
Yes, right.
But there's a plan of God until the fullness of time.
Yes.
And God has established America. And he actually breathed into those early settlers, into the Pilgrims and into the forefathers, the breath of God for Christianity in this nation.
Amen.
If you look around, you'll notice that American is not a genetic thing and it's not a color.
Amen.
You can be yellow, you can be black, you can be white, you can be brown, you can be red, you can be polka dotted.
Amen.
An American is a spiritual thing. God set this nation between two great oceans over the millenniums for just the last few hundred years.
Wow.
We just had our 240th birthday. Are you kidding me? How young we are?
We are
the Declaration of Independence. I mean, we just had our 240th birthday. And here we are, a nation of people from all nations, from all continents, and from the islands of the sea. And the people that have come together and created the greatest nation in history. And I'll parentheses right there with the possible exception of Israel's golden years of David and Solomon. But outside of that, the greatest nation that's ever been. The most powerful nation that's ever been. And this nation has been propagating the gospel of Jesus Christ back to all those nations and to the islands of the sea. Like no nation in history, including Israel. And we're standing with Israel as a protector and a big brother.
Amen.
And regardless of some of the problems in Washington, we're still standing with Israel.
Yes.
And now you're going to see that stand strengthened and straightened back up again.
Amen.
And it's not because of politics, it's because the church has been praying. Jesus.
Amen.
Ooh, hallelujah. And we decree, I've done it with you here before, probably more than once, but it bears repeating, 2 Chronicles 7:14, can we say it together as a decree? If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sins, and will heal them. Remember when he said, if my people, he wasn't talking about the general population. Because the next word was, who are called by my name. The Christians, the believers, the body of Christ. He said, if they will turn, if they will pray, if they'll come up into my face, he said, I will forgive the church. and heal the land. And that healing the land means that your grandkids are coming in off of drugs. The neighbors are going to get saved. It means that ugly boss down there is going to receive the Lord. Come on, help me here, somebody. Revival from sea to shining sea. It means a move of the Holy Spirit moving on the hearts of men and women everywhere. Doing what only He can do, changing the moral fiber of the country. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, shout with me, somebody. Talk about something that is in process right now. It is taking place right now. God is turning America back. He is not going to let America down. He will not do it. He's going to keep it up and keep it strong until the fullness of time. By that time, they can have it because you and I are out of here. When we come back, we'll be riding white horses. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to say this again. God bless America. God bless America. I pray that every day. I'm a bottom line guy. You can pray all of the itemization thing, but I get right down. God bless America. And He knows how to do it. And then God bless California, and then I pray over our county.
Yep. Amen.
Oh, hallelujah, Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, dear Lord. Hallelujah.
You know, back in 1996, matter of fact, probably before that, but John and Karen were having monthly pastor's breakfast. You still doing that?
I'm having monthly prayer meetings.
Okay. Yes. Well, I remember, did you start that in 95? Or, I can't remember. But anyway, we were as often as I could, we came down to it. And 93 and 94, the Toronto blessing broke out.
Yeah.
Father's Day of 95, the Pensacola outpouring started. And there was a unction and revival renewal in the air all over the place. Their hearts were burning. It was a move of God taking place. It was in my heart. I could feel it in my chest like a freight train. It was explosive. And it literally drove me, put fire in me to attend John's breakfast because he had basically spirit-filled pastor youth, sometimes 20, 30 of them, probably more. And one of those breakfasts, I asked John permission that the next month, would he mind if I talked to those pastors about putting together a meeting, to actually establish a meeting where we all come together and pray, like another breakfast, and pray about doing a meeting of all of us churches together somewhere in the valley, some common place. And just put a meeting, because there's so much unction in the air.
Yep.
And then just see what God would do. I mean, you can't create revival. You can't make it happen.
Yeah.
But you can create a heart, a passion, and a place for it. Yes. You can create the desperation for it.
Yes.
You can be ready to run with it if it happens in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
We can do that part.
Yeah.
And John agreed. He said, sure, you can talk to him. So I talked to him about putting together a breakfast. And we did that. And this was all taking place at the end of 96. And we established a morning for breakfast. And it was in February. I think it was the end of 96 when I talked to him about talking to him. It was the next month that we actually talked about it. And we set it up for a few weeks after that. But we set it up for a Monday morning at a restaurant in Merced, the Eagle's Nest Restaurant, for a bunch of us pastors to come together, take communion, and pray about putting together a meeting, and then see what God would do. In the meantime, after we established that breakfast, Gracie and I have been to Pensacola, and John and Karen have been there. And there was a place down there in Pensacola called Barnhart's Buffet. Buffet. You know, you buffet the flesh. And it was kind of a hangout from the people at the revival. And there was actually a great big billboard when you drove into town about Barnhart's Buffet welcoming the Brownsville revival. Anyway, I was standing in line to get some fried chicken or something at the buffet. And I heard this commotion over at this table. And I could tell they were a bunch of Holy Ghost nuts. And I stepped out of line, I stepped over there, and I said, by the way, anybody here happen to love Jesus? And of course, the whole place exploded. And in that, we met a couple that were on the prayer team. They weren't preachers, they were just on the prayer team. And we met them, and they wound up coming over our table and sitting with us. We had fellowship. Turned out they were from Southern California. They'd moved down there to be part of the revival. And I told them, I said, if you ever come to California, I'd like you to come up to Mariposa and just share some testimony. They weren't preachers, they were just lay people. And they said, well, yeah, that'd be fine. We don't plan to come too soon. But I said, well, if you ever do. Anyway, after we got home, about, it wasn't 2 weeks after we got home, I got this call.
I can't remember
the
name.
Raymond and Mary. Raymond and Mary, yes.
The SoCo.
That's right. Praise God. Anyway, Raymond called. He said, we're in Southern California. And I said, well, praise God. I said, why don't you come up here and share with my church? He said, oh, we can't, brother. We're here just a couple of days. We're heading back. And I said, would you please pray about it? He said, oh, yeah, we'll pray about it. He called me back a half hour later. He said, Henry, that wasn't fair. He said, God told us to go up there. I said, well, you better obey God. Well, we had them come up for a Sunday and Monday night. And it turns out that Sunday night was the night before the next morning we're having those pastors meet for breakfast.
Wow.
Talking about how God lays things down, and we're just blind walking, you know, just doing what God tells you to do one step at a time. And then you look back and look how he put everything together, right down to trying to get some fried chicken. And they came, and we just had our little church there, and it exploded.
Hallelujah.
I'm talking about spontaneous combustion explosion. It hit, and I mean it hit. It was incredible. Some of those people got so drunk that night they couldn't find their butt with either hand. Gracie and I've been all over the place, going to Toronto, going to Pensacola. We went to Melbourne, Florida, where it broke out down there. And we're not ones to give you courtesy calls, but we're wanting God to manifest on us. And I'd be on a prayer line with 50 pastors, and they all hit the floor, and I'm the only one standing there. Me and Gracie, the only two standing. And you're wondering, what the heck's the matter with us? Have we got some secret sin that we don't even know about? And all those places we've been and never manifested, I'm thinking, God, just wiggle my little finger, do something. And we got no manifestation, none. Never got one. And we actually got started getting depressed over thinking there was something wrong with us.
Yeah.
But that night, God broke that depression off of us.
Amen.
Everybody in that building manifested. They were, as a matter of fact, when the meeting was over, Grace and I were the only two standing.
Amen.
And there was another story that went along with that, but church up in Colderville, James Harrison's church, the day before, that morning, Sunday, he had begged me to come take his service because a church that he came out of that had rejected him and rebuked him is now asking him to come back and preach up in Twainhart, a big church of about 1,000 people. And it was a big healing thing for him. And he called me, he said, Henry, come, I mean, you got to come take my church Sunday morning. I said, I ain't coming. No, sir. I got people coming here from, they're going to be here tonight, but at night, but not in the morning. But we feel something's breaking out. He said, Henry, you have to. I said, nope, I ain't coming. And I said, I love you, but no, not now. And anyway, he finally talked me into it. And I was very confused. I'd love to go preach. So I left Gracie at home, and she ran our service, and I went and ran his service, and he went to that other church. And when he got to that other church, they sat him down. He thought he was this keynote speaker that Sunday morning, and they sat him down, and it just got destroyed. And when I preached his service, revival broke out in his church. And I mean, it hit. And at the same time, I didn't know it, but Gracie was having the same thing at home. And when he came back, it was about a 45-minute drive from where he was supposed to preach back to his church. Our service was over, but I didn't know what to do because everybody was on the floor. And I couldn't leave, just walk out on that. And then he showed up, and I looked up in the doorway, and he was standing in the doorway, and he was crying like a baby. He was destroyed. He was hurt. And yet he saw revival in his church. And then I wanted to hurry up and get back to Mariposa, and I couldn't. I knew. And I had to minister to him. And I took him out to lunch and ministered healing and encouragement back into his heart and spirit. And he said, you know what? I'm going to get a hold of my worship team. We didn't have a worship team. We were doing CDs. And he said, I'm going to bring my whole church over to your church tonight. And that set up when Ray and Mary came in. The two churches put together. And because we only were running 25, 30 people. And we're in Mariposa, you know, where there's no stoplights in the whole county. Somebody can praise the Lord for that. But anyway, the two churches together. The Basoko showed up. Revival hit. I mean, there's no advertising. We didn't even have email in those days. We didn't put out any mailers. This was just a little thing for our church. And they weren't preachers, so I couldn't advertise them as preachers. And all I was going to have them do is just share testimony of what they saw in the prayer, in the prayer lines and stuff. But when God rocks the place, he doesn't need Benny Hinn or Oral Roberts. Are you hearing me?
Right.
I mean, he exploded in that place. And Pastor James Harrison was drunk and happily drunk. And anyway, the next morning, now it's time for that breakfast. And God has loaded our gun. And Raymond and Pastor Harrison and myself all went together and went into that meeting, and all we said was, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, you may want to come to church tonight. But remember, we had them for two nights, Sunday night and Monday night, and that breakfast was Monday morning. The explosion was Sunday night, and the breakfast was Monday morning. And that Monday night, our little church could only hold about 120 people, and it was packed out. And again, when that service was over, Gracie and I were the only two still standing. And revival was born.
Amen.
Amen. A sovereign move of the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you this story because the roots of it started down here. Coming to John's pastor's breakfast. And that group of pastors is what provided the backbone and the atmosphere and the foundation for that thing to take off.
Amen.
And I'll tell you, I've been pastoring. Gracie and I just celebrated our 27th year now pastoring Mariposa Revival Center.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Longest standing pastor in the pulpit in the county, or in Mariposa community. And over the years, I've worked hard at unity, trying to get the church together, And of course, you talk about the Methodists and the Lutherans and all the issues and all that stuff. And trying to get pastors to meetings and stuff is like trying to herd cats. But when that revival broke out, when they got into that revival Monday night, one of the first signs I knew we had revival was 20-some pastors cleared to come. And nobody asked me. It was a move of God happening from the inside out. Nobody talking to them about doing that except the Holy Spirit himself. 20-some pastors, there was 30-some ministries when you include missionaries and evangelistic, but it was like 21 or 22 churches there in the beginning. And they were from all over the place. They were from this region. They were from Fresno, they were from Madera, they were from Chilla, they were from Las Banas, they were from Merced, they were from Atwater. They were from all over, Turlock. And it, after about 4 or 5 nights, one of the ladies, I think from Manuel Reyes' church in Atwater, called me one morning and said, "Henry, we're going to put out a poster on this and pass it around the churches, let them all know about it." And she said, "What will we call it?" You know, usually when you've got a big conference or a big meeting going on, it's got a name and all that stuff, and you're advertising up ahead of time. But a revival is like trying to fix a jet while it's in flight. And we're 4 or 5 days into it, never even considered a name for it. But she had to put something on that flyer. And I had, at Pensacola, had bought John Kilpatrick's book, Feast of Fire. And when she said, "What do we call it?" I looked down on my coffee table and saw that book. I said, "How about Feast of Fire Revival?"
Yeah,
and that's what it became known as, the Feast of Fire Revival. Amen. All this stuff is after the fact.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
God exploded. Spontaneous combustion.
Yes.
Amen.
And we were 3 days in Mariposa, and then we took that same bunch of pastors, and we started having breakfast every so often to kind of facilitate it and not control it, because you control a revival, you kill a revival.
That's right.
But we were facilitating, there's another word and I can't think of it right now, but we were doing what we could to keep the revival going, let God be God.
Yeah.
And not control of that. And we knew that this thing couldn't keep going in Mariposa because the crowds were bigger and the remote area and all that stuff, and there's no facilities up there to hold the people. So what we decided to do in the pastor's group is every pastor would have it to his church a particular week. And that we would do Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Keep it off the Wednesday nights and keep it off the Sundays so it didn't compete with and hurt anybody's church services. So we did Thursday, Friday, Saturday every week. And 1 week we're in Atwater, the next week we're in Merced, the next week we're in Madera, the next week we're in Las Vegas and Fresno and Turlock and Colville and back to Mariposa. And when it came back to Mariposa, we had to have it at the fairgrounds because it wouldn't fit in my church.
Yeah.
And we rented the building at the fairground, and John had a word, and I put it in the book. And this was at the fairground on April the 19th, 1997. It said, "There's coming a great move of God's healing power to the Mariposa area. It will begin in the churches and flow out into the streets and eventually down the mountain into the valley floor."
Amen.
I didn't know hallelujah, but
awesome.
That's where you get it.
Yeah.
It will be the talk of the town of Mariposa. Many people who have fought against or misunderstood the move of God will see that God is moving in his healing power. And they will not be able to deny the move of God any longer. There will be several different churches involved in the move. And just as the Feast of Fire Revival started here, this stronger move of the healing and miracles will begin here also.
Amen.
Yeah. The key part of that is it would start in Mariposa and flow down into the valley.
Amen.
I praise God for Mariposa. We want revival in Mariposa. But Mariposa does not have many people. And revival's got to get where the people are.
Amen.
And this valley has people. Millions of people. And I believe there's an initiation, a beginnings thing for Mariposa. Just like being the mother of counties. There's a whole lot of firsts that started in Mariposa and then went statewide and went actually national and worldwide. The first public lands in history are Yosemite National Park, which is Mariposa County. First lands in any country that was ever preserved for future generations started in Mariposa. There's a whole list of firsts. But the idea of Mariposa is where it starts. But where it's really got to get to is to the multitude.
Amen.
It's got to come down the mountain. It's got to come into the valley.
Yeah.
And I decree that what God has already done in Mariposa,
yes,
that Feast of Fire Revival, as great as it was small compared to what God needs to do and what He's going to do.
Yeah.
Ecclesiastes 1:9, it talks about that which has been will be again.
Yeah.
And I believe that's just a shadow of things to come.
Hallelujah.
And I'm decreeing right now, if y'all would agree with me, that revival is coming down that mountain and flooding this valley in Jesus' name. And there is a Mariposa Madera connection. I came to Madera. I got on fire down here. Madera came back up to Mariposa and revival started up there. And then Madera comes up there and prophesies a word to the whole valley.
Yeah.
Come on, shout with me. There is an unction in the air right now. Revival is all over the place right now. I'm not just whistling Dixie. I'm talking about, you know, Gracie and I, since that book came out back in 2010, God basically busted us out of our little church. And now we're pastoring California.
Amen.
I've fought smallest and smallest. I've never had anything small in my life. We built the biggest, one of the biggest river companies in the world back in the 60s and 70s. We showed horses nationally with national champions and world champions. And then all of a sudden, I'm pastoring this little church. And it stays little. And I shahika halalakashaka. But we stayed faithful. Now we're pastoring California.
Yeah.
He took us into the burning fiery furnace, but at the bottom of that thing, in the pit, in the prison, in the heat of the fire, He gave me a prophetic word for the state, and it's an incredible word because America leads the world in the end time harvest, but California leads America.
Yeah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Yeah.
We are on the move in California. I'm telling you, because of that book and God giving me this word, we've been preaching in 50, 60 cities every year all over this state.
Yes.
From the Oregon border to the Mexican border, so I can tell you, I've seen it. We know we're like bees cross-pollinating all over the state.
Amen.
I can tell you over here what you're doing over yonder. And I can tell them over yonder what you're doing over here.
Amen.
And I'm telling you, God's on the move in this state.
Amen.
It's a remnant, but it is a huge remnant. It is on fire. It's spirit-filled. It's full of desperation and hunger. It's paying a price.
Yes. Yeah.
I've got a pastor friend in Santa Cruz, and he's got a small work there at Hilltop Ministries, but he's got connections with a huge Baptist church in Santa Cruz that is Baptist. Somebody say Baptist.
Baptist.
The Baptist pastor made a mistake. He's allowed this pastor friend of mine to come in on Sundays and minister to his men. The mighty baptism in the Holy Ghost and spirit-filled things are starting to spread through that church. I'm talking about over 1,000 people, Baptist church. And just a few weeks ago, the Baptist pastor stood to the podium on a Sunday morning and said, "Folks, things are about to change totally in this church."
Yeah.
and worked with the men and got right up to the pastor, and now the pastor's spirit filled. Come on, shout that in my mouth. God is on my loose. There's a group up in Loomis, California. Anybody know where Loomis is? Up there, it's actually out Interstate 80 east of Sacramento, almost to Auburn. Little place, but there's a cement company there that they've got an ingredient that goes in cement. They don't actually produce cement, but they, this additive for cement makes cement impervious to water, three times as hard as normal cement. And they're spirit-filled believers, and they actually got the, I'm going to call it recipe for this thing, from an old Jewish man in Israel about 30 years ago. And the Lord put it in their heart to start a upper room prayer meeting at 7 o'clock on Thursday morning. And they call it the Moxie Upper Room because it's a Moxie cement company. And they up in their industrial building there was an upstairs, and they went up there and built that thing so it'll hold about 120 people. Then the back wall is the western wall in Jerusalem. And get a hold of this. Loomis, which is way outside of Sacramento, packs out 120 people. Thursday morning at 7 o'clock, it's standing room only, every Thursday morning. People are coming from Fresno, they're coming from the Bay Area, they're coming from all over the Sacramento area, they're coming from Modesto. They've had me up there preaching twice. And I mean, you want to feel like you're a good preacher, preach to that bunch. Because I mean, they're jumping and shouting and screaming. I think I could recite the Gettysburg Address and they'd be shouting. Yeah. 7 o'clock Thursday morning. Who ever heard of such a thing? There's a revival just broke out about, I don't know, 4 or 5 months ago, maybe longer than that now, down out of San Diego County. Yeah. And that thing's been going on and on and on. Yeah. I got a friend that's doing street ministry, carries a cross in Vice City. And he's telling me, Henry, people are getting saved on the streets now like never before. It's like just barely starting to talk to them and they're already receiving Jesus, right? They don't have to do the same old thing. They're telling me the same thing in street ministry in Monterey and Santa Cruz. And I'm just scratching the surface. And there's a whole lot going on out there I don't even know about yet. How many of you have been to the Santa Maria Healing Room, please?
Yeah. Whoa.
Rick and Roy Taylor, who are friends of ours, and we had them come up and do the teaching at our church, I don't know, 12, 13, 14 years ago, and they were using the Vineyard Church there and had a couple of rooms. Now he's got a big multi-million dollar building that they bought and paid for cash. And he's trying to buy another big, I'm talking about modern, out by the airport, right on the expensive corporate drive out there. And he's got 58 people on full-time payroll. People flying in from all over the world and staying there for days and getting their healing. They're coming in every day. I'm talking about stuff that is going on.
Amen.
I'm telling you, California is not going under, it's going over. It is not the bottom, it is the top. I'm telling you, California's been lied about. God had this place named the Golden State for a reason.
Amen.
It wasn't coincidence, but it's Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit, it's a remnant, but it's a huge remnant in this state, is on fire, full of passion.
Hallelujah.
They're praying, they're rising up. In that 2 Chronicles 7:14, it's basically God saying, church, rise up. Church, come up into my face. Church, catch fire. Church, repent. Church, cry out. Church, decree. Church, prophesy. Church, come alive. Can you feel the anointing on this message?
Yes.
People say, Henry, you're anointed. I don't know. This message is anointed.
Amen.
Every time I go to preach, it's like a step into another realm.
Yeah.
And if it's anointed, it's because it's a timing. And because we're stepping into a place where God is moving.
Yes.
And the message is promoting the boom.
That's right.
And the people are receiving.
Yep.
And I decree right now that everybody here, don't just hear it, but receive it.
Yes.
And become it.
Yes.
It's not my message, it's God's message, and it's for you to take a hold of it, and at all the realms of influence that you walk in, you spread this spirit in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Joshua and Caleb, 12 spies, 10 got stupid. There's negativity all over California. Spirit-filled churches saying, no, we're going under. I've had spirit-filled people in church say, Henry, we're so outnumbered, we're doomed. I'm saying while I'm preaching, Henry, we're doomed, we're outnumbered. I'm going, my God, what Bible are you reading? My Bible says one can earn 1,000 a flat, two can run 10,000. My Bible says to Abraham, if I find the 10 right, I won't destroy the place. Ezekiel 22, he says, if I find one intercessor, just one.
Yes.
Come on, shout with me here.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah, that's right. All we've got to do is believe God.
That's
it. And then God goes to moving. Yeah. When God goes to moving, I'm telling you, that democratic spirit's ugly, the liberal spirit's ugly, the devil's ugly, they're big and they're powerful. But when God goes to moving, they can't go blow fuzz off a peanut.
That's right.
Oh, he doesn't go poof. And a little poof went Tuesday night.
Come on.
Come on, shout with me here, somebody. That's just a little poof.
Thank you.
Oh, hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
So here, a couple of years ago, God gave me a message, and I think I've shared it with Pastor John. And, you know, for 25 years, Gracie and I were in the river expedition business and running the river trips all over the western United States. We ran the Stanislaus and Tuolumne here in the Sierras, and ran the Rogue River in Oregon. Salmon, the Middle Fork of the Salmon, the Old River, No Return up in Idaho, 6 day 100-mile trip down the Salmon River. Green and Colorado River in Utah, and our main trip was the Colorado River through the Grand Canyon. 300-mile, 7-day run. Wildest waters in America. Had an awesome time. So God speaks to me in river terms. And he said, son, you're on the river of life. And you're coming into the confluence of the ages. And you know what a confluence is? It's a joining of rivers.
Yes.
When one river runs into another, when the tributaries meet, that's the confluence. And he says, you're coming into the confluence of the ages, and we're fast approaching. And there's going to be all kinds of streams coming in fast. The increase of the prophetic.
Yeah.
Technology. Witty invention.
Yeah.
The revivals all over the ages. I've been a kind of a student of revivals. The Welsh Revival, the Hebrides Islands, the Great Awakening, the Finney Revivals, and all the revivals. And every one of those revivals was an awesome move of God, but each one was different than the other. Each one had a particular dynamic. But God showed me that we're coming to a time when all the dynamics of all the revivals at one time are going to start pouring into the church. All the anointings on the old generals of faith, the great people of God, the Catherine Kuhlmans, the A.A. Allens, the Branhams, and Oral Roberts, and all of them. All of those, each one of them had a particular dynamic of Jesus, but nobody had it all. But now he's going to combine those all together. And those are all going to be flowing into the body of Christ. And there's finances. The wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just.
Amen.
There's a whole lot of things that God has held back as we're coming into that time. And I really believe part of that coming into the confluence of the ages, it's all exciting and wonderful, but coming down the river, how many of y'all have been through some rough water? I've been through some fires, been through some tests. Some places where even God shut up the womb. Hello? But when he shuts the womb like he did with Hannah, he doesn't do it for less. He picks somebody he trusts, and he does it because he wants more than you want. Hannah wanted a baby. Fact is, God wanted more than a baby. He wanted a prophet of God. He wanted a judge of Israel. He wanted a writer of scripture and an anointer of king. His vision was way bigger than Hannah, so he knew Hannah, so he shut up her womb. You go, whoa, what's this about? Because he wanted that baby birthed in the spirit. And then conceived in the natural, birth in the natural. So he found somebody he trusted, and she travailed, and she prayed, and she cried, and she fasted, and she travailed until finally she got so much anointing on her, the backslidden priest got anointed to move the word. And finally he said, go your way, you got what you want. And if you read that verse right there, it said her countenance changed. She knew she broke through. She knew she birthed that baby in the spirit. Are you hearing me? Some of you have been going through some stuff and it doesn't make sense. I heard a preacher say one time that when the battle you're going through is bad, it's man. When it's evil, it's the devil. But when it doesn't make any sense, it's God. Because God's the only one you can pray for it to go away in the name of Jesus and it won't work. But when he does it, it's for more, it's not for less. But you have to hang in there. Your partners don't quit. Your partners do what Hannah did. Keep driving. Keep pushing. Pushing right up into the face of God. Travail. She knew right where to go. She didn't fail. And finally she broke through and she birthed that baby in the spirit. And then she conceived in the natural. And she had the prophet of God and did what she did. She dedicated him to God. And that's what we want. We want revival, don't we? Because we want to give it back to God. We don't want to have it controlled. We want to facilitate it and present it to God. We want him to give us California, give us Arizona, give us America. Because we want to give it back to you in Jesus' name. And then she got how many more babies? Five more? Anyway, she broke through. But if sometimes if you're up against it, it may not be the devil, and it may not be because you've been so ugly. It may be because God picked somebody, he found somebody he can trust. And my word to you is stay encouraged, stay on fire. And I'm telling you, be like David hastening towards that giant. Who does that uncircumcised Philistine think he is? Have that attitude that because of the power of God, because of the promise of the word, that giant's coming down in Jesus' name. In this case, even though it's God, he wants you to have that heart and that spirit and not quit and keep pulling up into his face. And then he gives you the breakthrough.
Yes, sir.
And that breakthrough is 10 times more than what you thought you wanted.
Yes,
oh, hallelujah. Come on, shout with me.
Hallelujah. Jesus.
We're coming into the confluence of the ages.
Yeah.
Amen.
And over in Haggai. This thing's got a sinking spirit on. Well, what's up there? Where's that guy, Lord? Yeah, Zachariah, one block to the left. Yeah, that ain't going to stay there anyway. Now, before I read this, I want to give you a piece of information. We live in Mariposa. Mariposa is on the south end of the mother lode. Yes, ma'am.
Say,
yeah. That's why I need grace. On the south end of the mother lode, thank you, everybody. The mother lode is a mile and a half or so wide quartz ledge that is loaded with gold. It's about 120 miles long, and Mariposa is the south end of it. And the north end is Sierraville, clear up in the mountains out of Sacramento. And all the commercial miners and all the PhDs, the geologists, will tell you, since Marshall discovered gold in January of 1848, they've only mined about 10% of the gold out of California. And it's millions of ounces that they know of. And there's a whole lot of gold they don't know of, because back in those days, you didn't check in with anybody, you just took your gold and left. But the Division of Mines in California knows it's what they know of is over 109 million ounces. Which is trillions of dollars in today's dollars. And they only got 10% of it.
Wow.
Okay. Now in Haggai 2.
Yeah.
Verse 6. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, yet once it is a little while,
yeah,
and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. Anybody seen any shaking going on lately?
Yeah.
And I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come. And I used to preach that's Jesus, but it's really the treasure. And of course, Jesus is the number one treasure. Amen. And I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. And then it's really strange. He's like, he jumps off subject and gets confused on what he was talking about. And he says, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. And then it's like he gets back on subject. In verse 9, he says, and the glory of this latter house shall be greater than the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts. Now here he's talking about shaking a nation. He's talking about pouring out the blessing. He's talking about restoring the glory to the house in the end time. But in the middle of that, he said, by the way, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. And then the glory of the latter house shall be greater than the former, saith the Lord of hosts. The first immediately following the silver and gold is his. Now you think about California. More international ministries were launched out of California than any place in the history of the world. We lead the world spiritually. 1 Corinthians 15 talks about first in the natural, then in the spirit. And we had the natural gold rush started in 48 and 49. And then just a few years later, on a grand scale of time, in 1906 at the Azusa Street Revival, God revealed his real plan of the spiritual goal for California.
Amen.
And he exploded that Azusa Street Revival, which was Latter-day Pentecost, to the entire world.
Amen.
And now as you and I stand here right now, every spirit-filled, full gospel, charismatic, any kind of spirit-filled church or meeting, anywhere in the world, somewhere its roots come back to California. The whole Pentecostal movement and charismatic movement was reborn out of California. And it's covering the world right now, and tens of thousands of people a day are getting saved because of that move that started in 1906. And then after that, he started launching international ministry after international ministry out of California, to where today no place in the world has ever come close second to the amount of gospel that's been preached out of a place as California.
Amen.
We lead the world spiritually. There's no contest. No place comes close.
Come on.
We're coming into the confluence of the ages. All the revivals that have been awesome, powerful, some of them world-changing moves of God. But the revival that we're approaching is going to dwarf anything we've ever seen. I can literally say to you, you ain't seen nothing yet there. And here's what I believe. I believe there's a direct correlation between the 10% of the gold that we've gotten out of California and the revivals and the moves of God that we've had so far, and the 90% that's still in those mountains waiting for them. I believe it. And I really believe that that gold was reserved for the end time harvest. And God's had a timing. And part of that timing is some of the stuff you and I have been going through. Some of the fire, some of the tests, some of the trials. Burning off the chaff. And like gold, it has to be heated in the fire. The dross comes to the top and the dross has to be removed to purify the gold. And you and I are that spiritual gold. And I really believe that the anointing that's coming and the finances that's coming with it is going to be so incredible that if we haven't gone through a test, kind of like Tommy Kenny said one time, I got to where I don't trust anybody without a limp. Hello? That God has put us through a bunch of stuff so that when it comes, they can trust us with the glory. And I'm talking the finances and anointing. When people get healed, the prophetic words are coming. If we haven't been through it, if there hasn't been some character building, it'll go to your head and you'll go off the end. And we've seen some big ministries already that went to their heads and off they went. The gifts and callings are without repentance. But the blessing isn't. The word promises you gifts and callings without repentance. He'll lead you anointed. But he'll let that anointing take you right over the cliff. Pastoring in Mariposa this many years, I've had a lot of speakers, some of them young anointed speakers. And I've been disappointed in some of the young anointed speakers.
Yeah.
A couple of times I needed to talk to them and they wouldn't listen. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm getting more healing than you are, so I don't have to listen to them. And, you know, it might take a year or two or whatever, but pretty soon you hear they crash and burn.
Yeah.
And I'm one of the, I've got to see character before I'm just not interested in your anointing until I see character. I don't care if I get all kinds of reports of things happening in your meeting. If I see bad character, I'm just going to pull back and wait. Pray for you. I'm not going to be super impressed.
That's a good word.
Hello.
Amen.
That's a word to all of us. Down in there where we live, between us and God. I've got to have revival. That changes who I am. In that secret place where nobody else knows but me and God. That's where I've got to be pure hearted. I have to, because we've got to have a revival. Nothing else will turn this nation around. Only God can turn this nation around. It's going to take some people that are sold out to Him, that are paid the price, and people that He can trust with the glory and the finances when it's poured out. In the name of Jesus. So embrace your fire. Let it do its work. Don't get depressed. Praise your way through it. I preached a sermon one time, which side of the Red Sea do you have to be on before you can dance? Miriam got them all together and did the right dance, but the wrong day in the wrong place. Absolutely wrong. Right dance, wrong place. None of those people made the promised land. When they were trapped in that Red Sea, mountain on both sides and the biggest army on the planet, that wasn't doomsday, it was opportunity. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
After everything He showed them coming out of Egypt, it was their opportunity to praise God. Hallelujah. Let's see what God's going to do next. Come on, I'm talking to you right now tonight. And He finally parted the Red Sea, rebuked Moses for praying. He said, what are you belly aching to me? What's that I put in your hand? What did I tell you to do? Stretch that thing out. Part them waters. They march on through on dry ground, get out on the other side, and then dance. Too late. 3 days later, they come up to some bad water hole. Started belly aching again. That wasn't a bad water hole. That was opportunity water.
That's right.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Am I talking to anybody here?
Yeah.
Huh? Anybody here repenting tonight? Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Somebody say revival.
Revival.
Move with the Holy Spirit.
Move with the Holy Spirit.
That's what we've got to have.
Yes.
But it starts right down in here, each and every one of us. We've literally got to go to that cross and die. We've got to die, fellowship with his death, and then fellowship with his resurrection. The old man's got to pass away. And behold, all things need to become new. We're coming into the confluence of the ages. And I want to speak and prophesy right now. The Joshua Caleb spirit. They didn't see giants that they couldn't overcome. They saw a promised land of pomegranate sticks and grapes. By the way, just another one of those coincidences. Guess what state leads the nation of pomegranate sticks and grapes? You guessed it. It ain't Texas. But that Joshua Caleb spirit said, we're well able. Not because of all their numbers or who's giant or who isn't, but because God was with them. God had given them a promised land. And that Joshua Caleb spirit, I release it here right now. Anybody receive it? Raise your hand up right now. They were of a different spirit. That Caleb spirit, in Jesus' name. We are well able. We are well able. We're going to take Madera. We're going to take Madera County. We're going to take California. We're going to take America back in Jesus' name. We are well able to take the land and add revival to the nation. What around the world? Oh, shit. Oh, my God.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
Anybody getting a hold of this?
Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Now the state motto. Anybody know what it is? Eureka. You know what Eureka means? I found. Matter of fact, I looked it up and the more extensive reading is a famous exclamation attributed to Archimedes in the 16th century, a Greek scholar. And it means a sudden, unexpected realization of the solution to a problem. I have found it, which the first time it was proclaimed, he proclaimed it on his discovery of a method of determining the purity of gold.
Amen.
Think about that. And I'm telling you, we're coming into that confluence.
Amen.
With the invention.
Yes.
God is going to be releasing the prophetic like never before. The anointing like never before. There's business strategies. God's going to be giving businessmen that just like to come out of the blue. But it's going to be businessmen that have been through the fire, been through the test, and got a little bit of a limp. But they've turned their life over to God. And it's going to be stuff that turns into millions and billions to finance the kingdom. And I believe that spirit of Eureka is being released right now in the name of Jesus. There's even going to be inheritances of things you didn't know anything about that is going to start coming into play. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. We've got things going on right now with California Gold. And there's a whole prophetic thing that prophets are telling me to put together a team of 49ers. And we're not talking football. Prophetic people that are going to start prophesying over the gold, prophesying on how to find the gold, prophesying how to process the gold, prophesying on how to put together a coalition and a camp to be able to use it for missionary, use it for the church, use it for humanitarian efforts. And just in the last few days, people have been contacting me and speaking over me. Henry, you have to lead it. Henry, it's about California. God's given you the anointing. And he's starting to put people behind me now that even from out of the state that have big gold connections, have ways of starting to detect gold. Some of them are coming up with ways to detect gold several thousand feet into the ground.
Oh.
And I don't mean gold, I mean all, every kind of mineral, and identify what kind of mineral it is. And some of you know Johnny Enlow, prophet, on Elijah List a lot, and he and his wife moved from Georgia to California here a couple of years ago, and somebody had sent him the book, God, Gold, and Glory, and they just devoured that thing because God had told them California is where it's going to take place and to get out here. So we built a relationship over the phone, and when they drove out, the first two nights in California, they spent in our house in Mariposa. On the mother lode. And God gave him a word that there's going to be technologies that are so accurate that they're going to be able to identify the gold that's in the ground and not have to mine it. Monetize it without mining it. It'll be so exact. Instead of mining it all out, turning it into bars and coins and all that, and then putting it back in the ground like Fort Knox, just leave it there and monetize it where it's at. Well, right now, California is the worst state in the nation for mining, for environmental law. Well, it's the absolute worst. It's number one for bad. But I believe that's God.
Amen.
And God showed me, like, he raised up Pharaoh for his purpose. He raised up that environmental spirit. He wants us praying against it, but it ain't coming down until he says so. But when he says it comes down, all of our prayers will kick in like you're behind a great big dam and a big reservoir, and it's going to be a big burst through. In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
But if they can monetize the gold without mining it, that's going to end run around the environmentalists anyway.
Yes.
Think about it, huh? Yeah. In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus. And this is all brewing. And just, you guys pray, because we're working on programs right now, meeting with people this next couple of weeks on how to go at acquiring gold properties up and down the mother lode. It's taking place right now. It's been prophesied over us the last 2 or 3 years, and now it's starting to develop.
Amen.
Come on, shout with us. God is on the move. I release that Eureka anointing in here right now. Somebody say Eureka.
Eureka.
Somebody say I have found it.
I found it.
Somebody say it's coming.
It's coming.
It's mine.
It's mine.
I release that Eureka anointing in here right now. A sudden realization of a solution to a problem. In Jesus' name. I have found it. It's coming into your life. With the intention, the goal itself.
Thank you, Lord.
One of those prophetic words says God's going to be putting gold where gold never was.
And I believe that.
You go out and dig a post hole and hit the mother load. Yeah. Everybody be digging up your backyard. Oh, thank you, Lord. You're in, huh? You're going. Praise God. I'm surprised you're still here.
Yeah.
Jeez. Here's a new gold rush. Spirit filled revivalist on fire. I release it right now. Fire, passion, revelation, Eureka, Joshua, Caleb, spirit. We are well able to take the land. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Revival. Revival. Move of the Holy Spirit. Release of the glory. The glory of the latter house greater than the former. Shehika, halalabaka, shanga. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. I'm decreeing. You shall decree a thing. And it shall be established. And light shall shine upon my way. I decree it. I've got agreement in here right now. Can I get an amen? Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, I'm telling you, this is real. This isn't just a good message to preach, not just something for a shout. I'm telling you, there's been prices paid. It's been prophesied and prophesied and prophesied. It's in the Word. God has given us the substance of revelation of this thing. And I'm telling you, we're on it. We're moving into the confluence of the ages. And you and I have been given the opportunity to have the baton that takes it across Jordan. That's a fact. This is the generation that's taking it in. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. The silver and the gold is mine. And the glory of the latter house shall be greater than the former. Saith the Lord of hosts. And we are in the golden state that leads the nation, that leads the world in the end time harvest.
Yes.
And God has given us the privilege of having a revelation of what he's doing. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Right now? I say yes, I mean all of us. And I release that impartation spirit on you right now. I've spoken before, but you receive the heart and the spirit of what I've been releasing in here. I like to think it's more than a sermon, that I've released the spirit. That's the Spirit of God for the times.
Yes.
And if you take it and you have that impartation spirit, the same thing he put on Azusa Street.
Right.
Just like being hungry and desperate. They didn't have to be theologians. Just hungry and desperate. When they came, it got on them, and wherever they went, it broke out.
Yeah.
And that's how Pentecost started covering the world.
Yeah.
And I speak that over you right now. That you'll be able to change and affect in a positive way all the realms of influence that you walk in.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Your families, your workplaces, your recreational places, your social places, your neighborhoods. That you'll be able with a loving spirit, with the anointing of God and revelation of Jesus Christ, you'll be able to change the realm of spirit. And that negativity, and break it, and pull that stronghold down.
Yes,
because you've received the impartation
here
tonight. Yeah. In Jesus' name. Yes. Thank you, Lord. Brother Michael. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
The meaning was God is able. What was
San
the word?
San Joaquin.
Yeah.
The word San Joaquin means God enables and God raises up.
Wow.
You guys live in the valley that means God enables or God raises up.
Wow.
Yes. Thank you, God.
Yep. I'm one of those like to look what do things mean.
Yeah.
You know, Mariposa is butterfly in Spanish. The butterfly means new beginnings and coming forth, and sure enough, Mariposa is a place of new beginnings at first.
Amen.
But you live in a place of God raises up or God enables.
Hallelujah.
Grace, do you have anything?
I have one thing I'd like to share.
Yeah, please.
Well, I'm not going to give you the whole spill and all the books and stuff, but do drop by the book table. Do buy that book. You need to know about your faith.
That's right.
There's so much going on, and what he's sharing with you is in that book. Learn about it and be prepared for this great revival that's coming.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. There's one particular word I want to give to all of you. So receive this. We went to Israel in November of last year, and the Hoffmans were with us. We had a group of 33. We were there for 16 days. And on the last day, on our way back to the airport, we purposefully planned to go to a prayer room they had there in Jerusalem. And it was in a business building about 24 stories high. We're on, like, I think, the 22nd, 23rd story. And it was all glass. And that was specifically a prayer room in this tower. And we had the room to ourselves. I want you to picture this in your mind. It was just sunset over Jerusalem. Oh, so beautiful. Just the red hue of the sun. You're overlooking the city of David, the Mount of Olives.
the place where Jesus was crucified. You're looking out over the glass, through the glass, at this beautiful, beautiful vision. And the Lord gave me one word, the tower, and that was shift. He said that is for the body of Christ for 2016, that he is going to shift in your lives. And it was good what I felt in my spirit. I never heard that spoken before we left America. But when we came back home, the word shift was spoken by the prophets, by the prayer groups, by the pastors, even here in the government officials, shift. So I want you to lift your hands. I'm going to declare that over you tonight. Lord, I say shift over every life in this room. I say shift in Jesus' name. Shift from what looks impossible to be impossible. Shift over finances. Shift over lives. Father, let them embrace it. Embrace it when it comes, people. It's going to shift you up. And in 2016, in Jesus' name, Father, I release that over them. Glory to God. And I want to tell you, in March, our lives started shifting. We've had so many shifts in our life. Even this thing with the gold, it's shifting fast. Things are happening fast in 2016. But you've got to embrace it and not be afraid of the change. He's taking you from one place to another, one situation to another. It's because of the great move of God that's coming. Amen? So that's a word for each and every one of you in here. Amen? And can I give just a few quick words to the young man in the orange shirt there, sweetheart, to stand up? I saw your feet in like a tar pit, unable to go forward tonight. He's loosening your feet from being bound up in tar, and you're going to start running in life. We're in the prayer room that you're going to birth revelations like you never have before. Father, birthday revelations like you never have before in Jesus' name. Oh, God's going to take you to your place, my brother, like you've never known before. Jesus, Jesus. And my sister, I saw you going across America to the nations, and everywhere your feet were, there were gold chains coming out the right heel of your foot, and you were leaking revival to the states and leaking it to the nations and the nations to America. And I bless your feet wherever they go. Father, that the gold, Father, she takes the gold from California right now. It was gold chains coming from your right foot. So, Father, she's going to leak. She's going to leak in Jesus' name. And, Monica, I saw you standing at like a water fountain. And the women were lined up as far as you could see with infants in their arms, hurrying to get to you. You were taking water from the fountain and anointing each infant, anointing them, blessing them. The women could hardly wait to get to you. As you anointed them, you were declaring they would fulfill their calls in their life. And I bless you, mighty woman of God, for the anointing on you that you're going to impart in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. And Mike, I saw you as we were driving here. I saw you standing on a carpet like this one. And you had comfortable slippers on, like bedroom slippers for a man. And you looked down, and I heard you say to the Lord, "These are so comfortable, I can wear these." And they turned solid gold. And the gold was a blessing upon your feet. And the Lord has had you step into a position, and you're looking down, and you're going, "I'm very comfortable in this. I'm very comfortable in this position." And the Lord's going to bless you. We're putting your feet in those shoes. In Jesus' name, I bless you, Mike. I bless you.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, they were solid gold. Amen. John and Karen, I bless you. I don't know what's going on exactly in your life, but I bless you. I bless you. Your fire starters, your trailblazers. My gosh, what they've done. Glory to God.
Amen.
And sir, I saw you. Have I got 5 more minutes? I saw you sitting at a desk, like an old-fashioned desk, and you were writing something, and you put the pen down, and you walked away. And you've never come back to whatever God had you doing. And I heard the Lord say to you tonight to tell you, finish what you started. Amen. what that means, but I know you do. Then finish what you started, and we want you to get right after it, brother. Right after it, in Jesus' name. Glory to God. My dear friend, I saw you, go ahead, stand up, walking on a rocky road in your life, just lots of rocky road, and tonight is breakthrough, a shift. I saw in front of you a freshly paved, like the highways are freshly paved, no blockages. You know how dark and beautiful a fresh paved road and freeway is? And I saw you running. You got up on it, and there's no more stumbling blocks. You're free tonight to run for God told you to do. No more blockages if you are just so amazed and you're running, brother, like you've never done before, to complete what God's called you to do. Bless you, man of God. Amen. Amen. Listen, you stand up for a minute. I saw you with a basket in your hand, picking stones up in front of people, just bending down, picking stones up on this road in front of people. And the Lord said you were picking up roadblocks that were stumbling blocks from in front of people. And God was using you. You were clearing the path for them to go to Christ. Come here, I just bless you. And you were untiring, picking the stones up so that people could go forward. I bless you, woman of God. And he strengthened you for what he called you to do to set other people free. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And Pastor Purcell, I just want to bless you. You mighty man of God. Look what all you've created out here, brother. I bless you. You're an awesome example of the body of Christ. Father, thank you for creating him and giving him to all of us.
Thank you for that.
In Jesus' name, amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Man, thank you, Father. That's hallelujah.
Good. That's good.
You get in an atmosphere like this, you just stay for a long time. It's so peaceful. The presence of the Lord.
So wonderful.
Lord, I just pray over every single person here tonight, Lord. I know we're getting ready to leave. Lord, I just hook in with what Grace was speaking right now. I just speak the blessing of the Lord. I speak shalom, shalom over everyone in this place tonight. The peace of God. The peace of God. And Lord, I thank you so much for Brother Henry and Sister Grace, Lord, the word they brought to us tonight. I know everybody in here lives in California except for Jody and Sister Lenora, but I believe. And Lord, I thank you for the straight state that you've brought us to, Lord. And Lord, if we've said anything over this state, it's not of you, Father. We repent of that right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we just speak the blessing of the Lord in our state, Lord. And Father God, I thank you for every single person in this place tonight, Lord. You've honored us as we've honored you tonight. And Lord, I thank you for every person in here tonight, God. I thank you for the gifts, the equippings, the calls, the call of God in our lives, the talents that you've given them, God. I thank you that you show us by your glory, Lord, where you want us to function in this great state, God. I thank you for opening the doors of heaven over every single person in here, God, that wants to follow you and that has a heart for you, Lord. I thank you for touching us right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, just like that Golden Gate there in San Francisco, God, I thank you, Father God, that you will bring people into our territories, God. You'll bring people into our sphere of influence, Lord, and you will influence people through us. You'll give us divine appointments, God. Lord, I pray that over every single person in here tonight in the name of Jesus. And I bless them right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, the word that's been spoken in this place tonight, God, let it grow spiritual roots on the inside of our spirit tonight, God. Let it grow on the inside of us, Lord. Let us see who we truly are in you, Jesus. And the will, the plan, and the purpose will be played out in every single person's life. That God's will, plan, and purpose will be performed in every single person's life in this place tonight, God. We believe that. We receive that tonight in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Guys, love you guys. We'll be back again tomorrow night at 6 o'clock. Everyone say 6.
6.
We'll be back tomorrow night. Invite someone to come out tomorrow night. Amen. To receive the prophetic word. See, what we got here tonight, we got to take with us, and we got to decree and declare and be open to the Lord of what He said to us. Be open to Him so we can speak and do what He's called us to do. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. Love you. Sister Lenora will be ministering tomorrow night at 6 o'clock, so make sure you come on back. Make sure you stop by and see the books and the CDs they got out there. And feel free to receive some of those. Amen? God bless you.